it is my turn to welcome you to Intelligence Squared and to a debate among four extremely distinguished historians about one of the most controversial moments in 20th century history. In September of 1938, Prime Minister Neville Chamberlain, together with his French counterpart, agreed to let Adolf Hitler occupy the Sudetenland, an ethnically German part of Czechoslovakia, calling the crisis a quarrel in a faraway country between people of whom we know nothing. He returned home waving a promise, in that picture up there, signed by Hitler not to pursue war any further. So, was he right to do so? Those in support of this motion will argue yes, and those against will argue no. At the end of the evening, you too get to have your say, and you will vote by tearing your ballot ticket. I was told to show you this, in case you didn't notice that it was handed to you upon entry. And you tear it in two, and you vote by placing either the for or the against part, or there we go, sorry, for, against, into the ballot box. And if you are a don't know, which is almost inconceivable after this distinguished panel speaks, you're bound to have very strong views, then you should place the entire ticket in the ballot box. So each of my speakers is going to have 12 minutes maximum to speak, and at 10 minutes I'm going to ding my glass like this. So be warned, this is very harsh, very severe military discipline, which we have to impose on these military historians in the room. Our first speaker for the motion is John Charmley, professor of modern history at the University of East Anglia, who can now stand up, and he's the author of Chamberlain and the Lost Peace, as well as Churchill, The End of Glory. Also, as I recall, he was the author of a couple of controversial articles in The Spectator some years back, which addressed precisely these issues. Professor Charmley.
Thank you very much, Madam Chairman. If I can start with a quotation and finish with one. It is also a help to our country and to our whole empire and our whole decent, faithful way of living that it is known through the world that we were guiltless of the bloodshed, terror, and misery which have engulfed so many. Appeasement was a long-term policy. It had been pursued by British governments throughout the 19th and 20th century, with one exception, the Great War. The Great War did not suggest that getting involved in a ruck in Europe was really a very good idea. So, the first thing to say about Neville is he's simply pursuing a policy that had been the policy of the British Empire, with one disastrous exception. There was nobody in the 1920s and 30s arguing World War I had been a jolly good idea. In fact, the policy of appeasement, the policy of amelioration, and we should come back to these things, was reinforced by the experience of getting involved in World War I and that horrendous loss of life. So you could not have had a public opinion less favorable to fighting in foreign parts. Of course, it might have been open to the Prime Minister, to have done what a later Prime Minister did. Perhaps sex up a dossier? Really? I would have thought of all generations, this generation would know the folly, the utter foolishness of trying to take a country to war that does not want to go. That would not have conduced to one of the things that Neville managed to conduce to, which is a national consensus that by the time war came, there was no alternative. Now, if we are in the presence of a long-term policy, if we're in the presence of one reinforced by the slaughter of Passchendaele and the trenches, we're also in the presence of a policy reinforced by economic reality. In 1931, Britain had gone into, well, one used to be able to say the most serious economic slump in its history, but thanks to Gordon and company, we have a much worse one. God, it's probably being a historian, you keep having to revise your comparisons. Nonetheless, the slump was serious. The great and good man up there had been the Chancellor of the Exchequer who had helped nurse back a crippled economy. The Treasury warned we could not afford a long war. The War Office said we couldn't win a short one. Oh, how foolish of the Prime Minister to listen to his advisers.
No, I think, again, we know from more recent examples that it's really rather a good idea that prime ministers listen to the men who are paid to advise them, and perhaps to public opinion, and who knows, to Parliament, and who knows, they might tell the truth. All of these things Neville did. I will leave to my learned friend, Professor Stone. There are many reasons why the other thing that would have made war problematic was Britain had no allies. I do hope he mentions Ahmed Zog, but I don't think he would have deterred Hitler very much. But now to appeasement itself. It is much misunderstood, largely because of Churchill. Appeasement was not simply a search for peace. What's wrong with peace? I think we're all rather in favour of it, particularly those of us with young sons. It was not a policy of peace at any price, as I shall say at the end. But it was a search to prove whether peace was possible. But it was also two other things. It was a search to see whether, if peace was not possible, that would produce a united nation around a different policy. And it was accompanied by a sensible rearmament policy, not the one favoured by Churchill, full of medium-range bombers and make the country as bankrupt as Churchill was. Churchill was able to win the Battle of Britain because Neville Chamberlain's rearmament policy produced the most sophisticated air defence policy in Europe. Spitfires and radar, thank you, Neville. So it was not a peace at any price. It was not a disarmament policy. It was a search to see whether peace was possible with an iron fist inside the velvet glove. And when, in 1939, of course, with hindsight, everybody, as we shall no doubt hear this evening, has 20/20 vision. Hitler was a terrible man, well, nobody doubts that. So was Stalin. So was Saddam Hussein. So was Mussolini. In fact, I've never known a leader of another country who was not demonized by those seeking to go to war. That's not enough. If we are only to go to war on the side of nice people, with nice allies, we should probably be reduced to going to war with the Isle of Man as our sole ally. And why not? So we have a situation where you have a country that is still traumatized by the Great War, still wishes to find a peaceful way, an establishment, a political establishment that agrees, an economic situation that won't allow for it, a military situation that also won't allow for it, as Professor Stone will say, a foreign policy one that won't either. It's not that appeasement was the right policy, it was the only conceivable policy, as Professor Paul Kennedy of Yale has put it. It was the most overdetermined policy in British history, even if he was quoting Professor Paul Schroeder when he said it. Nor is it a complete failure. Because when Britain goes to war in 1939, there is a united country, which there would not have been if they'd gone to war a year earlier on a false prospectus. Hitler has no allies because Mussolini is mysteriously ill, perhaps tying his shoelaces. And France goes with Britain. So Britain has an ally, Hitler does not. Of course, in 1940, it all goes wrong. That's because the British and French army were crap. What was Neville supposed to do? Imitate Stalin and shoot the general staff? I fear some of the general staff had heads made of solid teak and the bullet would have bounced off. So appeasement, far from being a total failure, was an honourable attempt to see whether or not peace was possible. It proved beyond peradventure, and that's why the country was united, even in the trauma of 1940. Apart from Oswald Mosley and the BUF, who needed locking up, probably needed locking up earlier, nobody dissented. Well, apart from a few communists, but if you've got Oswald Mosley and the communists against you, you're probably right. So, to finish off, it was not only the right policy, it was the only policy. And I want to finish with a quotation. Whatever else history may or may not say about these terrible, tremendous years, we can be sure that Neville Chamberlain acted with perfect sincerity according to his lights and strove to the utmost of his capacity and authority, which were powerful, to avoid war, to save the world from this awful, devastating struggle in which we are now engaged. This alone will stand him in good stead as far as what is called the verdict of history. Well, tonight, ladies and gentlemen, you have the chance to be that verdict and to prove the author of those words, one Winston Churchill, right. So remember, when you come to cast your vote, vote Churchill, prove him right by voting for Neville. Thank you very much.
Thank you. So our first speaker against the motion is Sir Richard Evans, the Regius Professor of History and the President of Wolfson College, Cambridge University. And among his many books include The Third Reich in Power and The Third Reich at War.
Thank you very much. Madam Chairman, ladies and gentlemen, in 1935, Hermann Göring, known as the second man in the Third Reich, arrived late at his hunting lodge for a meeting with the British ambassador, Sir Eric Phipps. "I've been out hunting," he said. "Animals, I hope," said the ambassador. And Phipps's reaction showed how well he understood the murderous nature of the Nazi regime. "I have the impression," he wrote in one dispatch, "that the persons directing the policy of the Hitler government are not normal. Many of us indeed have a feeling that we're living in a country where fanatics, hooligans, and eccentrics have got the upper hand." Already in 1935, Phipps wrote, "Let's hope our pacifists at home may at length realize that the rapidly growing monster of German militarism will not be placated by mere cooings, but will only be restrained from recourse to its ultima ratio, i.e. war, by the knowledge that the powers who desire peace are also strong enough to enforce it." And when Chamberlain came to power in 1937 as Prime Minister, he immediately replaced Phipps with Sir Neville Henderson, who thought Göring was a gentleman and told the Foreign Office, "If we handle Hitler right, my belief is that he'll gradually become more pacific. But if we treat him as a pariah or mad dog, we shall turn him finally and irrevocably into one." History, Madam Chairman, ladies and gentlemen, history has shown that Phipps was right and Henderson was wrong. Chamberlain knew little about Europe and cared even less. And as you've already heard, he told his listeners in the BBC radio broadcast in 1938, "How horrible, fantastic, incredible it is that we should be digging trenches and trying on gas masks here because of a quarrel in a faraway country between people of whom we know nothing." And the country he was speaking of wasn't Mongolia or Antarctica, it was Czechoslovakia, just a few hundred miles away. He was slow to react to the German threat because he didn't take it seriously. And like Henderson, unlike Phipps, and the many well-informed experts on continental Europe who thought like Phipps, Chamberlain regarded Hitler as a normal, conventional statesman. "He is a man whose word can be trusted," he wrote in a letter to his sister. Hitler had given him assurances that he had no more territorial demands after the Sudetenland, the part of Czechoslovakia that was taken away and given to Germany in the Munich Agreement in 1938. Hitler's word was his bond. Waving the scrap of paper Hitler signed, Chamberlain told crowds that it meant peace for our time. And he should have known that Göring had referred to all treaties as scraps of paper to be torn up when they were no use anymore. Munich appalled MI5, who, according to the official history, were well informed enough to realize Hitler's aims were without limit and that Poland would be next. They sent Chamberlain a memo to try and stiffen his resolve with secret intelligence reports describing how Hitler was absolutely contemptuous of him in private, describing him as a worm and even an Arschloch, which the MI5 translated accurately and helpfully as asshole. It had no effect. Appeasement was even more dismaying to the German Army Chief of Staff, Franz Halder, who knew that Germany in 1938 was in no way prepared for a war with Britain, and planned the arrest of Hitler if war broke out, to be followed by immediate negotiations for peace. Halder even went to his operational conferences with Hitler, carrying a loaded revolver in his belt in case the opportunity should arise for a quick shot. Plans had reached an advanced stage for a coup when the Munich Agreement pulled the rug from underneath the conspirators' feet. They were simply stopped in their tracks by Chamberlain, who refused, of course, to believe that the Germans weren't ready for war. The Czechs had a strong army. They had defensible borders. With British backing, they could have resisted a German invasion. But Chamberlain forced them to surrender. The British government refused to believe that Germany wasn't ready for war, even in 1936, when German rearmament had made so little progress that when Hitler sent in his troops to the Rhineland and the west of Germany, which is a demilitarized zone by the terms of the peace settlement in 1919, the troops were under orders to withdraw at the slightest sign of Anglo-French objection. Had the French sent in troops, for example, Hitler said later, the military force at our disposal would not have been enough even for limited resistance. Strong action by the British in 1936 or 38 could have prevented war with all its disastrous loss of British lives. It would have encouraged resistance to Hitler within Germany. As it was, both the unopposed remilitarization of the Rhineland and the Munich Agreement over Czechoslovakia persuaded Hitler that he had nothing to fear from the feeble, witless British and their supine allies, the French. Far from calming him down, these events, along with the unopposed annexation of Austria in March 1938, all fruits of the policy of appeasement, made him accelerate his policy of conquest and aggression. Now, what you think of appeasement depends, of course, on what you think Hitler's aims were. Chamberlain, and I'm in full agreement here with Professor Cholmondeley, a decent and sincere man, thought Hitler just wanted a few revisions of the Treaty of Versailles in the name of the self-determination of the German people. But knowledgeable and intelligent men like Phipps knew from the very beginning this wasn't the case. And anyone who read Mein Kampf, Hitler's political tract from the mid-20s, or who listened carefully to his speeches, or who found out what he'd been saying to his generals, or even to American businessmen and correspondents, knew he was planning a war of European conquest and ultimately aiming at world domination. War was the essence of the Nazi regime. Men like Phipps saw this from the start. Chamberlain's horizons were too limited, too conventional to grasp this basic reality. There's no evidence that he had some kind of cunning plan to keep Hitler on hold while Britain rearmed. He was, in fact, naively obsessed with a desire to avoid war at any price. On the 2nd of November 1939, following the Nazi invasion of Poland, he appeared before the House of Commons, placing his faith in Italian mediation, extraordinarily in Mussolini, of all people, the most unreliable people in modern history. The members of the House of Commons, who knew full well that the Nazis were aiming for European domination, that Poland was just the first step, were furious. As the leader of the opposition rose to his feet, began with the words, "Speaking for the Labour Party," a Tory backbencher shouted angrily, "Speak for England." And a few hours later, an emergency meeting of the cabinet forced Chamberlain to issue an ultimatum to the Germans to withdraw. When this is ignored, a declaration of war was issued over the radio by a visibly shattered and disappointed Prime Minister. Now, let me remind you this point as I draw my remarks to a close. The motion is not whether Chamberlain was pursuing a tried and tested British policy. It's not whether this is the only policy available to the British government. It's not whether the Treasury didn't allow him any choice. It's not whether public opinion wasn't behind it. The motion is about whether the policy of appeasement, Chamberlain's policy of appeasement, was in the best interests of Britain. It was not a search to prove whether peace was possible. As I've argued, it was a desperate search for peace at any price. Appeasement was not in Britain's national interest because it prevented Britain and France from putting a stop to Hitler's drive for world domination when it was still possible to do so. Indeed, because it actually encouraged it. It was not in Britain's national interest because it undermined opposition to Hitler from the leadership of the German armed forces. It was not in Britain's national interest because Britain left Britain woefully unprepared for war when it came, as the disasters of the first year of the war showed, until things began to improve a bit with the Battle of Britain. And it wasn't in Britain's national interest, because leaving continental Europe to its own devices would have been a betrayal of staggering proportions, first for Czechoslovakia, then for Poland, then for the rest of Europe. If appeasement had continued, as Chamberlain wanted it to, even during the Nazi invasion of Poland, Hitler would have scored an even more complete victory in Europe than he did in 1940. Britain and the Empire would have been next in line. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Trust the Regius Professor of History to get it correct. It was peace for our time and not peace in our time. Right, our second speaker for the motion is Glyn Stone, the Professor of International History at the University of the West of England and the author of books on a huge range of subjects from Neville Chamberlain and the Spanish Civil War to Anglo-French relations in the 1930s. Glyn Stone.
You've heard my colleague, John Charmley, argue that appeasement was the best policy for the British government, and I have no reason whatsoever to disagree with that verdict. I think he has demonstrated very much that it wasn't only the best policy, it was the only policy. And in considering this question, we ought to also bear in mind that there ought to be alternatives to this. If it wasn't appeasement, then what was the best alternative? What was a better policy than that of appeasement? And historians tend to come up with, just as Churchill came up with and so on, with the idea of a grand alliance. A grand alliance of the powers, because after all, that was what has defeated the Kaiser in the First World War, and that was what, of course, eventually defeated Adolf Hitler in the Second World War. So it made sense, common sense, therefore, for Chamberlain and his government to construct a grand alliance to deter and to confront Hitler with war. Now, of course, the question is this realistic? And certainly, Chamberlain didn't believe it to be realistic. There was an occasion in March 1938 when he, in a letter to one of his sisters, he wrote regular correspondence with both of his sisters, he mentioned to her that the whole question had been examined. The idea of a grand alliance had been under great scrutiny, and the chiefs of staff had been involved and so on, and it was a marvellous idea in theory, but the problem was, in practice, that when it came down to practicalities, the whole thing disintegrated. And he was quite right. There was no way, no possible way of constructing a grand alliance in the 1930s that might deter and oppose Hitler. The only realistic combination in the 1930s of powers was that which actually materialized, that of an Anglo-French alliance. And that, of course, materialized in February, March 1939. Neither the Soviet Union nor the United States was prepared to commit to an alliance to confront and deter Hitler's Germany. Neither of those powers, whether Franklin D. Roosevelt or Joseph Stalin. If we look at the Americans, first of all, we see America deep in isolation. Ever since the fateful decision of 1919, when the Senate rejected the Treaty of Versailles and America's membership of the League of Nations, America had increasingly become deeply and much more isolated as far as international affairs was concerned. And the height of American isolationism was reached, of course, in the mid-1930s with the neutrality legislation passed through Congress, and that, of course, coincides with the period of Neville Chamberlain's government. Franklin Delano Roosevelt was reluctant to get involved in any of the affairs in Europe or in the Far East, whether it be Abyssinia, whether it be the Spanish Civil War, whether it be the Sino-Japanese War, which broke out in the summer of 1937. Chamberlain was absolutely correct when he said on one occasion, "You can expect nothing from the Americans, only words. Certainly not actions. That would be the last thing that America would offer." And the Czech crisis, of course, I think demonstrates this probably better than anything else. Because during that Czech crisis, time and again, American diplomats were discouraging both the British and the French from taking action that might lead to war. They, for example, Bullitt in Paris, that's William Bullitt, the ambassador in Paris, constantly telling French politicians and statesmen that they could expect no help from the United States. And indeed, at the height of the Czech crisis, when it looked like war was going to occur as the British Navy mobilized and as the French garnered their armed forces, and Roosevelt made an appeal to both Chamberlain, but also to Adolf Hitler as well, and followed up with another personal appeal to Hitler, appealing for peace and to find some way, a solution, so that there would not necessarily be war over the Czech issue. And when Chamberlain announced that he was going to Munich on the 28th of September 1938, Roosevelt sent him a telegram. The telegram was two words: good man, good man. And so when Chamberlain delivered the verdict of Munich, Roosevelt afterwards mentioned to several of his confidants that he was not at all disappointed about the outcome of the Czech crisis itself. And there's no doubt that Roosevelt was incapable, really, of persuading his Congress to adopt a more supportive policy with regard to Britain and to France. This is clearly shown when in 1939, during the spring and summer of 1939, the French were making a bid for American aircraft, trying to buy weapons from the United States to help with their rearmament. Congress refused. Even though Roosevelt himself was in favor of this, Congress refused to endorse what we call a policy of cash and carry, to enable the French and the British to buy weapons and other materials and pay for them with cash. That policy was only adopted in November 1939, after the war had started. If we look at the Soviet Union, we can see that again that the charge has been made against Chamberlain that he failed to secure an alliance with the Soviets, and that he was to blame for this because of his blind ideological prejudices against the Soviet Union. Well, there's no doubt that Chamberlain and his cabinet were all anti-communist. But at the same time, they were also, of course, aware of the Soviets. They were aware of the military problems that the Soviets were experiencing, largely because of the destruction of the Soviet High Command. The purges in the Red Army in 1937-38 put a huge question mark over the military credibility of the Soviet armed forces. But apart from that, there was also a question of trust. Could you trust of Stalin? Would Stalin actually make an agreement, an alliance with Britain and France? Well, at one level, it looked like that might be possible because negotiations took place in the spring and summer of 1939 to make an alliance. But in the end, of course, as we all know, Stalin opted for an agreement with Nazi Germany in the infamous Nazi-Soviet Non-Aggression Pact of the 23rd of August 1939. And the reason he did that was because he was able to gain massive benefits and advantages from that association. Benefits and advantages which he could not possibly have got from Britain and France. Britain and France could not sell Poland down the river, could not sell the Baltic states down the river, could not sell Bessarabia down the river. At the same time, they could not offer the sort of economic support which Stalin himself believed he needed. And Stalin was able, of course, to pay for that back by providing raw materials and foodstuffs to the Third Reich. And also, of course, by making the pact, Stalin bought himself time. Time to reconstruct the Soviet economy, and time also to undo the damage that had been done to the Soviet armed forces through the purges. Time, an absolutely valuable commodity, and by making that alliance, that was very much favourable decision for Stalin to make. But above all, with regard to this, there was also an opportunity with regard to the pact, that in actual fact, Britain and France might go to war with Germany, and that therefore there would be a war of the capitalist powers fighting each other. And if they fought each other in a similar way as they'd fought during the First World War, this would be a long war of attrition, and the effect would be that there would be, as I said, a long drawn out struggle, that the various parties would exhaust themselves, and this would leave Stalin, as Russia, meanwhile rearming for all it's worth, in a much, much stronger position to dictate the future of Europe. And there is no doubt that this was in Stalin's mind, because 4 days before he made a pact, he said as much to a meeting of the Politburo on the 19th of August. On the 23rd of August, President Beneš, former president of Czechoslovakia, now in exile in London, spoke with Ivan Majski, the ambassador of the Soviet Union, and again got the same message from Majski. And then on the 7th of September, a week after the war had broken out, in a meeting with Zhdanov, who was a member of the Politburo, with Molotov, the foreign minister, and with Georgi Dimitrov, the head of the Comintern, or Third International, Stalin again repeated the advantages and opportunities which would be available for the Soviets should this war continue for a long time, as he himself hoped it would. So there was no prospect at all of making any alliance in the 1930s, and especially in 1939, with the Soviet Union. And the fact is, of course, that Stalin would strive might and main after September 1939 to maintain Soviet-German collaboration, up to the point of even dismissing intelligence reports in 1941 about an impending invasion by Nazi Germany, which of course took place on June 22nd, 1941. This finally, therefore, leaves us with the one alliance which Britain had, that with France. The problem with France was France a credible ally? France was riven by social and political problems. And as a consequence of these problems, it put a question mark over the credibility of the French, particularly in terms of their rearmament, particularly the power of their military forces. And the bottom line was, at the end, that despite this, Chamberlain made an alliance with the French. And the two countries went together in September 1939 to fight against Adolf Hitler. They're the only two countries, actually, who declared war upon Hitler's Germany. Certainly Joseph Stalin and Franklin Roosevelt didn't. Thank you.
Right, our final speaker against the motion is Piers Brendan, the former keeper of the Churchill Archives Center and fellow of Churchill College, Cambridge, and among other things, the author of The Dark Valley, A Panorama of the 1930s. Piers Brendan.
Winston Churchill memorably defined an appeaser as one who feeds a crocodile, hoping it will eat him last. Like many of Churchill's impromptu remarks, this one was carefully prepared in advance, but it did not express his full mind on the subject. Appeasement, as he admitted, need not be a matter of cowardice. It could mean peaceful conciliation. Churchill also acknowledged that Neville Chamberlain, as John Charmley has said, had good motives for trying to appease the dictators during the 1930s. He wanted to avoid a repeat of the First World War. He wanted to right the wrongs of the Versailles Settlement, and to preserve the empire without jeopardizing the British economy during the Depression. However, as I shall try to persuade you, the appeasement policy, as actually implemented by Chamberlain, which sacrificed the Czechs to Hitler in December 1938, was an absolute disaster. When Chamberlain returned from Munich in triumph, clutching his umbrella, waving his piece of paper, and announcing that he'd brought peace with honor, Churchill was right to respond that Britain had been offered a choice between war and shame. She has chosen shame, and she will get war. Of course, Churchill himself was neither consistent nor infallible, but he did grasp the full danger of Nazism. As early as March 1934, Churchill alerted Parliament to the tumultuous insurgents of ferocity and war spirit in Germany. Chamberlain would not listen. Arguing with Churchill, he said, was like arguing with a brass band. He wasn't far wrong in that particular point, but Churchill had a better point when he said that Chamberlain, a good Lord Mayor of Birmingham in a lean year, looked at foreign affairs through the wrong end of a municipal drainpipe. Churchill couldn't see that Hitler wanted war. He thought he could do a deal. He offered him various titbits, such as the return of Germany's former colonies, not realizing how unimportant these were to Hitler and ignoring Bismarck's warning that he who seeks to buy the friendship of his enemy with concessions will never be rich enough. Hitler's insatiable lust for conquest, his pathological antisemitism, his insensate drive to win Lebensraum in the East, his homicidal quest for an Aryan world order, all this was beyond the comprehension of Chamberlain, who was a smug, vain, fundamentally naive man who thought that jokes in Christmas crackers were funny and liked to win at games of musical chairs, and only really showed anger when his umbrella got broken. The national government's first great act of appeasement took place in response to Mussolini's rape of Ethiopia in 1935. The Royal Navy could have crushed this in a moment just by blocading the Suez Canal, and this would have had a great moral effect throughout Europe and helped to shut Hitler up, or at least to warn him that we meant business. As the military historian Little Hart wrote, never again would there be so good a chance to check an aggressor so early, and the failure to do so in this case was the most fateful turning point in the history in the period between the wars. The national government, heeding the supposedly but not really a pacifist electorate, was timorous over in its reaction to Nazi rearmament, which violated the Treaty of Versailles, and to Hitler's reoccupation of the Rhineland in 1936, which violated the Treaty of Locarno. Equally feeble was their response to Hitler's seizure of Austria in March 1938. Lord Halifax, the kind of Christian, said Churchill, who deserved to be thrown to the lions, sent a pathetic protest, which Hitler contemptuously ignored. Meanwhile, a pogrom was taking place in Vienna, whose ferocity embarrassed even the Gestapo itself. Some of Austria's 400,000 Jews fled to Berlin, where the anti-Semitism was less acute. Despite such evidence of Nazi barbarity and belligerence, Chamberlain neglected potential allies. He cold-shouldered Roosevelt, ostracized Stalin, snubbed Daladier, once remarking that for the French premier, the darkest hour was always before lunch. But Chamberlain ardently wooed Mussolini, whereas Churchill agreed with Goering, practically anything they did agree about, which was that in any future war, it would be a positive advantage to have Italy as an enemy. In his eagerness to mollify Hitler, however, Chamberlain confirmed Mussolini's view that a decadent Britain was led by political eunuchs. He said that the Ethiopians had obviously caught them young. The Ethiopians went in for castration. The impression of impotence was compounded by Chamberlain's appointment of obtuse mediocrities, such as Sir Thomas Inskip, the Minister for the Coordination of Defence, of whom it was said that he could look with frank and fearless gaze on any prospect, however appalling, and fail to see it. Similarly, Chamberlain's rearmament programme was too cautious and penny-pinching to convince the dictators that he would stand up to them. At no risk to the economy, he could have done far more to provide the sinews of war. British soldiers understandably feared that the government's real aim was, as one said, not to fight a war, but to be able to pay an indemnity after losing it. Combined with half-hearted rearmament, wholehearted appeasement invited the aggression that it was designed to prevent. No wonder the French called Chamberlain Monsieur Jaime Berlin. Hitler was convinced that the democracies would cave in when he menaced Czechoslovakia in the summer of 1938, and he was undeterred by diplomatic hints that Britain would intervene if he used force, not least because the Foreign Office simultaneously pressed President Beneš of Czechoslovakia to yield by hinting that Britain would not intervene. Some officials did urge firmness, and even the head of the Foreign Office, Sir Alexander Cadogan, was shocked when Chamberlain argued quite calmly for total surrender. After Chamberlain's three airborne overtures to Hitler, which culminated in the cession of the Sudeten fringe of the Czechoslovakia, the German-speaking fringe, at the Munich conference, this saying echoed around Whitehall: if at first you can't concede, fly, fly, fly again. However humiliating the terms, though, Chamberlain's defenders argue that Munich gave Britain a vital breathing space in which to defend itself, notably with fighters and radar. Yet as John Chalmers himself acknowledges, this was not his intention. Chamberlain's main objective, says John, was to avert war, and he was prepared to go a very long way down the road of national dishonor to get his way. As it was, Germany made much better use of the year's grace than Britain and France. The democracies would have done well to fight in 1938, when the Luftwaffe had no plans or ability to bomb London. The French had a 5-to-1 superiority to Germany on its vulnerable western border, and 35 well-equipped Czech divisions, perhaps supported by the Red Army, would have embroiled Hitler in a war on two fronts. After Munich, no full-blooded rearmament program was initiated in Britain, largely because Chamberlain assumed that he'd secured peace. The British public was less gullible. After the initial euphoria about Munich, it quickly concluded with hawks like Churchill that Munich had been a total and unmitigated defeat, and that the Nazis were criminals whose hands are still dripping with blood and who have just slapped our embarrassed faces before the whole world. The abject failure of appeasement was confirmed in March 1939 when Hitler swallowed the whole of Czechoslovakia. Chamberlain's reluctant response was to guarantee the independence of Hitler's next major target, Poland, among other countries. Yet this did not mark the end of appeasement. It was a further attempt to contain and deter Germany, not a preparation for war, but a construction of a peace front. Anyway, the Times, which was an appeaser, softened its commitment to Poland, and Sir Neville Henderson, our pro-Nazi ambassador in Berlin, sabotaged it to the fury of Clifford Norton, the British charge d'affaires in Warsaw. And he wrote in an unpublished memo to the Foreign Office, this very interesting memo. The historian of the future may well ask what right Henderson had to falsify the British spirit and attempt to drag our name in the mud again. God knows, if Poland fights, it will be hell for her and for all of us. But there is a worse hell for cowards and traitors than for those who go down because they kept their word. Hitler was encouraged by other signs of appeasement, among them dove-like cooings from the BBC, Britain's surreptitious payment of Danegeld in the shape of foreign credits to Germany, the continued exclusion of Churchill from the cabinet, and Chamberlain's ineffectual courting of Stalin. Having seen the democratic worms at Munich, Hitler said he could not believe that they would now turn. Succumbing to his own illusions, he was convinced that the democracies would leave the Poles in the lurch. Chamberlain's own illusions flourished. Hitler has concluded that we mean business, he said on the 23rd of July 1939, and that the time is not ripe for a major war. That's 6 weeks, I suppose, before the war was declared. After the Nazi-Soviet pact, even after the assault on Poland began, he clung to the hope that Hitler might be peacefully placated. As a threat to Britain's existence and a menace to Western civilization, if not as the embodiment of evil, Hitler should have been confronted earlier. Chamberlain's tragically mistaken policy made his premiership the darkest hour before our finest hour. I beg to oppose the motion.
I can now announce these are the results of the voting that you did before you heard the four panelists speak. So before the debate, there were 25% for the motion, 41% against the motion, and 34% don't know. So I reckon that 34% is the for motion can still win if it wins over those 34% don't know. I will take questions in groups of three. Please make short statements. You can ask a question to one or to all of the panelists. Please. And I will do my best to see with lights blaring in my eyes. Right. Gentleman right here in blue.
Well, I mean, a key point which has only been mentioned by one or two of the speakers is the fact that Daladier, of course, gave full support to Neville Chamberlain throughout. Because as my understanding is that when the whole thing started got going in April 1938, Bonnet, the foreign minister, went to London and basically conceded, you know, said, whatever you decide, we'll support. And of course, and last one is that when Daladier returned from Munich, he thought he was going to be lynched, but in fact, he faced cheering crowds all the way, from the airport into Paris, and the French National Assembly overwhelmingly approved the Munich Agreement, with just the communists voting against. And this is a very important thing which should be borne in mind.
Right. In orange in the back.
Oh, hi. I wanted to ask about Guernica, if I've pronounced that correctly. Because for the first time, Guernica showed us that the war could come to the civilian population and not be fought in a far-off land. And I understood that we believed it was possible we could lose up to 60,000 civilians in about a week to 2 weeks from bombing. And that Guernica had taught us quite a lesson that Neville Chamberlain was quite aware of, and we were not prepared at that point to evacuate people. We didn't know about that, or we couldn't have done that at that point. Is that not correct?
Right, thank you. Correct. And one more, and then we'll have some answers.
Good evening. Piers Brendan talks of Neville Chamberlain ostracizing Stalin. Well, if talking to Stalin is such a good idea, what's so wrong with talking to Hitler?
All right. Okay. So maybe we'll start. There was one direct question for Piers Brendan. Maybe he would like to answer that, and then we'll.
Well, I'd like to answer the one in France.
Sorry?
On Deladier, I'd like to answer that.
And then you get Deladier next. So.
Okay, well, yes, I'd like to answer all of them. But
that would be cheating.
Yes, of course, it's the difference between a louse and a flea, isn't it? Stalin and Hitler. The difference, I suppose, is this, that Hitler posed an existential threat to this country, whereas Stalin had his own problems in the late 1930s. In the end, of course, it is absolutely true that Chamberlain did try to mend his fences with Stalin, but he did it in an extraordinarily inept way. He sent across as his emissary, not a senior politician to negotiate with Stalin, because he wanted to come to some sort of grand alliance with Stalin at this late stage. He sent an emissary called Admiral Sir Reginald Plunkett Ernley Earl Drax. And Sir Reginald Plunkett Ernley Earl Drax, when he arrived in Moscow, was greeted with incredulity by the Russians, partly because of his name, and partly because he didn't seem to carry any weight, and finally because it turned out that he didn't have any authority to act for the British government. This was the kind of ineptitude that that Chamberlain was guilty of. In other words, he did not make a serious effort to create anything in the way of a grand alliance. And Churchill, whose anti-communist record was greater than anybody's that you could think of, came to the awkward and embarrassed conclusion by about 1938 that the real menace was posed by Hitler, and that he would therefore have to swallow his anti-communist. He had written these wonderful things about how the Bolsheviks, like hordes of ferocious baboons, were hopping and capering over the ruins of civilization and all that sort of thing. But he came around in 1938, realistically, to saying what we need is the kind of alliance that we had in 1914 with the Russians.
Right, Professor Stern.
Can I just come back on that before I answer your Deladier one? Because we hear again and again about Neville Chamberlain and the negotiations with the Soviet Union, and that they didn't show any real seriousness or sincerity about it, and that the military mission headed by Drax is a clear proof of that. The fact of the matter is, it wouldn't have mattered if we'd sent all our top generals, we'd sent cabinet ministers or anyone else. Stalin was not going to make an alliance with Britain in the summer of 1939, because he had a much, much better offer. And that offer came from Adolf Hitler. And the offer contained, as I was saying in my speech, that things that Britain and France could not possibly give as democratic countries. They were not able to do what Stalin was able to do, Hitler cut a bargain with Stalin. So it's immaterial whether Drax went, whether it was a slow boat to Moscow, which has also been pointed out in issues of that kind. The fundamental and crucial issue was about whether or not the Soviet Union would support this country and France in a war against Nazi Germany, and Stalin had no intention of getting involved in that kind. They were all capitalist powers as far as he was concerned, and as far as he was concerned, the best outcome would be a war between the three, from which the Soviet Union itself would benefit. Deladier, you're quite right. In September 1938, the French are absolutely hysterical. about this coming war. And don't forget, it's their problem, more than Britain's. They're the ones who've got the Treaty of Agreement with the Czechs, not the British. We are no way obliged or committed to support Czechoslovakia in 1938. Absolutely not. And to be committed and to actually go to war on behalf of France, because that's what we would be doing, we would have to be absolutely convinced that we were putting our entire nation at risk, and I mean at real and genuine risk, on behalf of an issue of 3 million Germans rejoining the Third Reich, because that's what the Sudeten issue was about. And if that could be actually brought about, you could resolve that issue then peacefully, then that was worth it very much. And if you could also get Hitler's agreement to conduct diplomatic relations in a more peaceful manner in future, as proposed the Anglo-German Declaration, that would be as well. But can I just say, when Chamberlain was coming back from the airport in England, and he made that silly statement about peace in our time and so on, he actually turned to Lord Halifax and he said, Edward, we must hope for the best, we must prepare for the worst. And therefore it made absolute sense to pursue a policy that would ensure that you would continue to try and strive to reach an agreement, but that you were not going to denude the defences of your own country, you were going to prepare it and make it ready for war subsequently if that proved impossible. But for Daladier, can I just say one point? The French were absolutely hysterical because they had no way of defending their country by air. The French Air Force was way behind that of both the Royal Air Force and the Luftwaffe. Voulamin, the French chief of air staff, told the Daladier that the Air Force would last at best 6 weeks. So they had every reason to support Chamberlain at Munich.
Professor Evans, you were interested in answering the question, war could have hurt civilians. We weren't prepared for that.
Yes, there's a reference. There was a question about Gernika, which is a Basque town, which was bombed to bits in the Spanish Civil War by German bombers of the so-called Condor Legion, and with serious loss of life. And it was this led to kind of widespread fear across Europe of bombing. It was thought that the next war would be an air war, and there was no really satisfactory effective defense against aerial bombardment. Now, Chamberlain typically, of course, was extremely ill-informed about the German, what he regarded as the German military threat. The Germans didn't actually have a very effective strategic bombing force, certainly not in 1936, 7 or 8, and with severe limitations even in the Battle of Britain. He enormously overestimated the German potentiality, but the real effect of Gernika was in Germany itself, where people were absolutely terrified of the next war. Hitler did not have support amongst the ordinary German people for a war. The secret reports of the SS surveillance service, which talk and I've listened to people in queues and on trams and so on, made it quite clear that in every crisis, 1936, the remilitarization of the Rhineland, 1938 in Austria, 1930, and in Czechoslovakia, people were suffered from what they called a war psychosis. They were absolutely frightened that there would be war. In the beginning of September 1939, the American correspondent William Shirer went out when war was declared looking for the cheering crowds that had been there in August 1914. Nobody. Streets absolutely empty. Everybody very depressed about a war, with some justification because the Germans weren't prepared either.
Professor Charmley, that Chamberlain overestimated the German potential and the Germans were not prepared or enthusiastic for war. True, false?
Nor were the British. The difference is Hitler could afford to ignore his public opinion because he wasn't going to be elected to anything. Chamberlain had this odd belief that as a democratic prime minister, he should actually listen to what public opinion, a very odd view, and clearly not one that modern neoconservatives, or indeed those who seem to think that some weird sort of ethical foreign policy would have worked in the 1930s, would share. Well, that's fine. Fact of the matter is that the policy advocated by the other side simply was not practiced. There's no point with 2020 hindsight saying, we know this. We didn't know it then. And everybody is a winner. I mean, you know, if you ask me what last week's lottery numbers were, I could win it for you. The other side are very much knowing what last week's lottery numbers was after the event.
One sentence,
Professor Evans wants one sentence. Yes.
History is all about hindsight. Without hindsight, we wouldn't be historians.
Right. Hindsight, right. Three more questions. I see a married couple quarreling. Who gets to ask the question?
Got a war.
Okay. The wife is conceding, husband first. And then in the white shirt there, and then one more up there.
Is it not true that both the Canadians and the Australians had made it quite clear that if we had gone in 1938, they would not have been with us? And that being the case, is it really conceivable that without the support of the Commonwealth, we would have had the British people truly on side in time to get the effort going?
So, question about Canadians and Australians would not have gone with us in 1938. Next.
Basically, my question would be that if we had attacked Germany, and we declared war and we were going to attack Germany at that point, wouldn't that have actually driven the German people to support Hitler in the defence of Germany, and then you're into a full-blown war, and then even if you win that, you're back in the space of where we are with Iraq today, for instance.
Right. Let's see some applause here for the question. And there was one up here.
No, none up here.
No, resigned. Okay. Somebody else. Front row there. Right. We got to wait for the microphone.
What was Chamberlain's calculation with regard to Poland when he offered guarantees? Did he simply mean to prolong the transition, to have longer period of preparation for war, or did he mean it seriously?
Right. Was Chamberlain serious about Poland? So, Professor Charmley, is it correct that the Canadians and Australians would not have supported war in 1938, and wouldn't that have riled up the Germans as well?
Yes and yes, jolly good points. If you go around declaring war on people, they don't say, oh, that's a joke. They fight back, and oddly enough, if you declare war on them, their people rally round the regime. On the empire point, absolutely right. People sometimes say that Britain stood alone in 1940, which is another one of those Churchillian exaggerations. They actually stand with the United Empire around them. And actually, if you look at what the Canadians in particular contribute to the British war effort in 1940, it's tremendous. They would not have been there in 1938, nor would South Africa, nor indeed would the rest of the empire. I mean, this is the problem. People forget that Britain was not a little offshore island back then. Worldwide empire. Oh, let's ignore the empire. Again, it's very well to say, of course, we're all historians with hindsight. What one shouldn't do is to ignore the circumstances of the time. As Lord Macaulay, a very great Whig historian, once said, the real task of the historian is to remember what is now past was once the future, and people know as much about it as we know about our future. And I think that's a very good point to make.
Right. Professor Evans.
Let me just remind you again of the motion, which is the best policy for the British government in our judgment, knowing what happened later. That is all about history is all about results and outcomes. And we are in a very privileged situation. We know what happened. And from that point of view, we can judge whether Chamberlain and the British government were right or not in their policy. As for the question about Germany 1938, just to remind you that, as I said, General Halder and a whole bunch of leading generals were ready to stage a coup d'etat if a war broke out. So those who were the only group who were in power, who had enough power, clout, who were able to stage a conspiracy of that sort, would, I think, have acted without if there had been a war. Germany was weak in 1938. They knew it. It didn't require the entire British Empire to fight against the Germans. Just one push, and it would collapse from inside.
Groaning. Instead of groaning, speak. Yes.
I'm groaning almost, because how can a democratic leader base a policy on what might happen if you take or don't take particular action with regard to oppositions within another country, whether the army would or would not have acted in that way? How can you take a risk that might then lead to a war which will involve the lives of millions and millions of people? And that was the thought at the time, that the war would bring huge civilian casualties as well as battlefield casualties. But it's interesting to note in September 1938 that, first of all, you have the Sudetenland. Well, the Sudetenland is where the fortifications are. And the problem is there's lots of Germans in the Sudetenland. And what are they going to do? Which way are they going to go in terms of that? Can the Czechs rely upon the loyalty of their German population? And also, it's clear, Peter Jackson, historian of French intelligence, wrote an article a number of years ago in which he pointed out that French intelligence was absolutely convinced that the Czechs would be rolled over in a matter of days. So this argument about whether or not there were formidable fortifications, formidable Czech forces, etc., is one, of course, as all things, debatable. And from the French point of view at the time, there was a clear feeling that Czechoslovakia would not be able to withstand assault by the German forces. And bearing in mind, of course, as well, that what the French would have done was mobilise behind the Maginot Line.
Right.
They had no real offensive capability to actually attack Germany.
I see desire for response on this side.
Yeah, of course, the Czech army was extremely well-equipped. It was very modern, up-to-date, unlike the Poles. It had defensible lines. The Germans were certainly pretty convinced that there would be a really hard fight if they tried to invade. They did not think there would be a rollover. The question was that, again, I think the Germans were in a position in 1938 where they felt weak, they felt vulnerable. That was a moment for Britain and France to put their foot down and say it's not going any further, even more so in 1936 when Germany barely started to rearm.
Right, three more questions.
There is a problem.
A very quick one, which is I think that we haven't sort of examined the nature of Chamberlain's prime ministership. One MP said that he was the Führer of the Conservative Party. In other words, he was not a weak prime minister. He was a strong prime minister, and one of the things that he did very very consistently, as my book still available in all good bookshops.
Waterstone's still open after this, ladies and gentlemen.
Shows is that the propaganda incentive was terrific during the late 30s. I mean, the Times was on side, the BBC was, so involved that even Children's Hour could not broadcast programs about current affairs. The Rex Leeper, who was in charge of the Foreign Office's propaganda department, said that he could turn around British opinion in 3 weeks. Simply by using the propaganda weapons at his disposal. And where the Commonwealth was concerned, they tended to follow the line that that 10 Downing Street was pursuing. And therefore, I don't at all think that it's a foregone conclusion that the Commonwealth would not have come round had there been a leadership that was actually defending Britain's national interests in 1938 as opposed to sacrificing them.
Right, three more questions. And of course, the speakers can return to some of those that were unanswered in this round. I know, but we'll catch it in a later round. Okay, so.
Okay, my question is with the opening remarks that appeasement has been used over almost a century of foreign policy previous to World War II. And the fact that Britain was unprepared up until declaring war. Would you therefore advocate that going to war over Poland was actually the wrong thing, and that in fact Britain should have let Hitler take Poland to not get involved in the war, in which case are the kind of the freedom of nearly half of Europe an acceptable casualty to allow us to live comfortably at home in the United Kingdom?
Right, so another question about Poland. Was it an acceptable casualty? Next.
Professor Cholmondeley attempts to put Chamberlain's policy fit it into the pattern of British foreign policy during the 19th century. I would put it that that's wrong. British policy in the 19th century was indeed built on non-involvement with Europe, but it was also strong defense of British interests and credible deterrence, which did, on one or two occasions, lead to war. I would say Canning, Castlereagh, Melbourne, Disraeli, and of course Palmerston, none of them would have behaved as supinely as Chamberlain and let potential opponents have vital victories at Britain's and its allies' expense.
Number three.
No one's mentioned the resignation of Anthony Eden. He resigned before Munich on the basis that he and Chamberlain had fallen out because Roosevelt had suggested to Chamberlain that Roosevelt would chair a peace conference in 1938. I'm curious to know why none of the speakers have mentioned this point, because Eden had a clear vision of an alternative. We've been offered two alternatives, either war or peace. Eden had a different program, and he resigned because Chamberlain wouldn't agree with him. I'd like some comments on that, if possible.
Right. Thank you. Three good questions. We'll start with number one. This one was directed directly at Professor Cholmondeley. Was British policy in the 19th century, in fact, based on a long involvement with Europe? And did Chamberlain, therefore, was he therefore long out of step with what had come before?
If I can try and deal with both that one and the deterrence issue, because they are actually part of the same thing. I think that the evidence is that whereas, for example, with Portugal or Spain, British sea power could be used, then certainly Britain was able effectively to intervene. However, when it was a matter of Central Europe, say, for example, the Austro-Prussian War, even the Franco-Prussian War, and one only has to mention, although one doesn't want to get into it, but we are in the Royal Geographical Society, the Schleswig-Holstein crisis, and the plain fact of the matter, you're quiet. So the plain fact of the matter is that certainly where Britain's deterrence could be used, that's the Navy, Britain intervened. Where she could not, she did not. And last time I looked, Poland wasn't really amenable to British sea power, and Czechoslovakia was landlocked. So I think that in that sense, Chamberlain's policy was exactly one with that of the 15th Earl of Derby, with that of the 14th Earl of Aberdeen, where it involved an area that Britain could not fight. They actually agreed with Canning, which is it is better not to bluff where you cannot be effective. But of course, if only we'd known all the German secrets and we hadn't listened to our intelligence, well, if me auntie was me uncle, she'd have a different set of equipment.
Right, we have a taker for the Anthony Eden question. Role of Anthony Eden, significance thereof. Piers Brendan.
Anthony Eden's an interesting figure. He was the son of a half-mad baronet and a very beautiful woman, and somebody said that he was a little bit of both himself. and the problem with Eden was that he was highly emotional, and he fell out with Chamberlain. Really, I think because he felt miffed that Chamberlain had taken a front seat in foreign policy. I think Eden was pretty overrated. He was, as Beaverbrook described him, he was a rebel in velvet gloves, and he was not really. He was regarded by Churchill as a sort of white hope of the future, I don't think that, I think the proof of the pudding was in 1956, where he proved that he wasn't the white hope at all, that he was an absolute disaster area. I think he didn't represent any serious resistance to the appeasement policy. If you look at what he said, he was very feeble, and after he'd resigned, he didn't really support Churchill in his assault on appeasement. So I would say, really, that Eden is a bit of a broken reed in this particular area, and I'd certainly always have preferred Churchill drunk to Eden sober.
Right, well... we've now had one word about Eden, and then we're going to move to Poland.
Because you did raise the question about Roosevelt, and about the Roosevelt Initiative, as it's called, which was based on a secret telegram sent by Washington in January 1938, offering the prospects of an international conference to discuss disarmament, etc., etc. That plan was first conceived by Sumner Wells, a member of the State Department. His boss, the Secretary of State Cordell Hull, didn't agree with him. They were in dispute over this within the Washington circles for a while. But in the end, the president sent this telegram asking whether or not the British would take the lead in requiring a conference to be held. Just at the point when, and asking for disarmament, at a point when the British are really, actually now really gearing their rearmament. And Chamberlain, believing quite rightly, that this was again just another gambit by the United States, more words, nothing to reinforce it. Sent a mild rebuff, and it wasn't much of one, and certainly Roosevelt didn't take offence, and in the end, the Sumner Wells Initiative, as it really was, fell in March 38. The point is that afterwards, Churchill, and Eden trying to make a huge great play of it, trying to say this was, in Churchill's words, the best chance to avoid a war. What was he talking about? There was no prospect of avoiding a war based upon some American verbal commitment. The fact of the matter is, in 1939, in September 39, the Secretary of State for War in Washington had to admit that the Americans didn't have one available division to actually fight in Europe. That was the state of the American military establishment. Only 2% of American gross national product was devoted to rearmament in 1939, compared to 23% for Britain, 28% or thereabouts for Germany.
Right, we had one other question, which we've now had in two versions. Going to war over Poland, wasn't that a waste of time? Shouldn't Poland have been, wasn't it an acceptable casualty? We should have let Hitler occupy Poland. Professor Charmley.
They're both very good questions, and indeed they both illustrate why Chamberlain's policy was right. Because by 1939, it had become clear you didn't need secret intelligence reports anymore. You certainly didn't need some press attaché trying to sex up dossiers. Pretty dangerous line. Let's not do that. People aren't actually that stupid. You can't actually change public opinion in 3 weeks, whatever a boastful chap says in his diary. What changed opinion was Hitler breaking his word. What changed opinion was what happened to Czechoslovakia and what looked like it was going to happen to Poland. As Glynn said, there were only two countries in World War II that went to war voluntarily. That was Britain and France, after they had exhausted all other possibilities and precisely the same factors which for much of the 1930s militated against involvement, in 1939 convinced most people, Harry Pollitt, the leader of the Communist Party, and Sir Oswald Mosley apart, that the moment had come and there was no alternative. And that is why when the disaster happened in 1940 and Britain was almost alone and under tremendous threat, public opinion did not crumble. Churchill was right. Hate to contradict him on one of the few occasions when he's being modest, but he was right when he said, I gave the lions roar. And the reason the lion was roaring in favor of a war where it had not previously is that Neville had gone to the farthest and to the uttermost. And we can see, and everybody could see in 1939, there was no alternative. That was not clear in 1938.
Right. Yeah. Professor Evans' response.
It was Chamberlain himself did not see that in 1939. He was still appeasing away when Poland was being invaded, that he was overruled by the House of Commons and died a broken man a few months later. There was no limit to the policy of appeasement. It was not something which was going to have an end for him. He thought Mussolini could intervene. Now, my point is that Poland was not the actual subject of the declaration of war. The reason for war was that a final realization in British political elite that and military elite that Germany was about conquering the whole of Europe. And I agree with Professor Cholmondeley that that realization came in March 1939 when Hitler invaded the non-German speaking part of Czechoslovakia. But of course, all of this could have been prevented in 1936 over the remilitarization of the Rhineland. The French could have been prompted by the British to move in and invade and stop the Germans. It could have been done in September 1938 when the British were prepared for war, but it was not. Also, of course, one shouldn't just poo-poo intelligence. Intelligence reports were coming in. There's a sort of curious footnote. The older members of the audience may remember Peter Ustinov, who was a wit, raconteur, and actor, and his father, Klopp, was actually an intelligence agent. And Ustinov remembers, when he was young, a group of people in great secrecy coming up, tramping up the stairs to the flat to talk to his father. It turned out later these were people who would come to tell the British intelligence service that the German generals were going to overthrow Hitler in 1938 if it came to war. Did Chamberlain take any notice of it? No, of course he didn't, because he was blind to this kind of thing in his manic pursuit of appeasement.
Right, I will take three more questions and then we will be slowly moving on to summing up speeches. So,
I think I'm right in saying that Churchill was appointed First Lord of the Admiralty by Chamberlain. Is that correct?
Yes, he was.
Yeah, so does this not rather give lie to the fact that the proposition that Chamberlain was not ultimately opposed to Nazism by appointing Churchill, who, if you follow my point.
Right, this is the Luftwaffe is coming. So. Then there was one, sorry, blue shirt there, and then one, we'll take one more from the top, and then we'll have summing up. The one, right, this man right here.
Would the panel agree that every time Chamberlain appeased Hitler, Germany got stronger? So, for instance, when Germany took over Austria, they managed to take over all their reserves. I think it's about £800 million, which is very valuable to them. And when they took over Czechoslovakia, they took over their industries. So by appeasing Hitler each time, he actually made him stronger. And when it came to war, it put us right behind the game.
And now we had one over here.
During the 1930s, not now in hindsight, but during the 1930s, one crisis after another, you could see that Hitler was achieving territorial gains and appeasement kept continuing and he kept making more right. territorial gains.
Hitler was making territorial gains. Okay, one final question. This is the final question. Then we will have summing up speeches in which the panelists can answer whichever of these questions they choose.
Before Munich, Hitler had written Mein Kampf looking for Lebensraum in the East. He had imprisoned large numbers of the Communist Party and killed many more in Germany, and he had taken opposite sides as Stalin in the Spanish Civil War. Did Stalin really make a trade with Hitler because he thought he could get more out of it, or because he was desperate at the lack of serious cooperation from the British and the French?
Right, thank you very much. So four final questions. Appeasement, the easiest policy for the British in the 1930s, the best for Hitler. Every time Hitler was appeased, he gained more territory and more power. I will let the panelists think about these questions and as they prepare their summing up speeches. And while they do so and while they speak, ushers will be coming around with ballot boxes for the final vote. And once again, a reminder, you vote by tearing your ballot ticket, which was handed to you upon entry, in two, and you vote by placing either the for or against part into the ballot box. And if you are a don't know, then you should place the entire ticket into the ballot box and vote for both sides. Okay, summing up, speeches will be made while you vote, and they will each last 2 or 3 minutes, and we make them in the reverse order to which they were, the speaker spoke at the beginning. So first goes Piers Brendan.
I'm thoroughly unprepared to do this. What I feel is the most important thing, really, is that the origins of this business of appeasement go back to 1935. I was very struck by looking at 1935 and discovering that popular opinion was absolutely outraged by Mussolini's occupation of Ethiopia, not least, of course, because he was using poisonous gas and because the British, who had got completely foolproof evidence of the fact that he was using poisonous gas, refused to condemn him on that. Halifax got up in the House of Lords and said that he couldn't impugn the honour of a great country. But the British public, and I think again and again it comes back to this in a democracy, what do the people think? And in 1935, what they thought was strange, because we ourselves had had a long imperial tradition, that they thought that Mussolini's behavior in Ethiopia was absolutely disgraceful. Now, there was an easy option, which we did not take, namely of blocking the Suez Canal. I think this would have satisfied outraged public opinion in Britain. It would have isolated Germany, and it would have sent a signal to Hitler that that we were not political eunuchs, that we could in fact stand up for ourselves, and it would have. Something that we haven't talked about at all, it would have served notice on Japan, because don't forget that what was going on all the time from 1931 onwards was the continual nibbling away of China by Japan, breaking out into a major war in 1937. The Second World War started in 1937 in the Far East. This, I think, had we made a stand there, had we made a stand the following year over the occupation of the Rhineland, which would have been easy. The Germans hadn't got any proper bullets in their guns. They had dummy bullets, and they were under orders to retreat if any opposition was shown. It would have been the easiest thing in the world to stop Hitler early. And in 1935, we'd have been backed by public opinion. So I sort of see the justice of what Churchill said in his book on the Second World War, when he called it an unnecessary war. I rest my case on that.
Right, thank you. Glyn Stone.
I'd like to emphasize the kind of strategic problems faced by Britain in the 1930s, because we had not only to consider Europe, we had to consider the Mediterranean, we had to consider the Far East as well. And it would have been massively helpful to the British if the Americans had come in and helped us in the Far East. And certainly Chamberlain hoped that the Americans would do that, but they failed to offer any real support in the Far East as much as in Europe and elsewhere. This created really problems for our rearmament, because we had to rearm our naval, air and land forces, and that would require enormous amounts of investment. That investment was made on a considerable basis, both through increased taxation and through loans and so on. But in the end, it would never be sufficient to actually beat Germany by ourselves, or even in tandem with the French. Well, I want to look at the First World War to see that it had taken four great powers to finally bring Germany to surrender in 1918. And indeed, it took a combination of powers during the Second World War to achieve that as well. And there was no prospect of us being able to do that, or fighting a war, certainly to win a war, more importantly, probably not to lose a war, without the support of other great powers. And the United States was, in a sense, the real problem. If the Americans had been prepared to give that kind of support, then maybe it would have been a different story. But it's interesting to note that in 1914, when we're actually now at war with Germany, along with the French, during the period called the Phony War,
Sumner Wells came to Europe and visited Paris and Berlin and London, and he talked about making concessions to Germany. He actually angered Chamberlain because he wouldn't even consider the idea of dismissing Hitler. He was prepared to actually even think for a moment about Hitler continuing as the leader of Germany. And as I said, Chamberlain was incensed. That was the kind of thinking that was going on in the State Department through the 30s and into the Second World War, that there was still a possibility of making a settlement and of reaching some kind of agreement with Hitler, even in March 1940. Fact of the matter was, what they didn't want, what they really feared, and is what they got, was a Europe, particularly Eastern Europe, that would be dominated by the communists. And in the end, that is what happened. Their failure to give real and concrete support to Britain and France ended with their great nightmare, that in the end, Europe was divided, and it was divided between communism and capitalism. Thank you.
Thank you. Richard Evans.
Just to come back to one or two of the last questions, did appeasement make Germany stronger? Yes, undoubtedly. Did appeasement encourage Hitler? Yes, I argued that in my speech. Did Stalin do a deal with Hitler because he despaired of the British and the French being able to do a deal? Yes, he was desperate, of course. One thing we all agree on, I think, is that the Soviet Union was weak after all the purges of the armed forces, munitions factories, and so on at the end of the 1930s. Stalin was terrified, wanted some kind of temporary stability while he put things back together again. I just want to come back also to Professor Stone's arguments about Britain seeking alliances and so on. All of this would not have been necessary had appeasement not destroyed the credibility of the League of Nations. The League of Nations was what was or collective security. The idea that what happened in 1935 with the invasion of Abyssinia was that the League of Nations attempted and made a valiant attempt to try and condemn Mussolini, to try and raise sanctions. All of this is very popular in the United Kingdom, but it was completely sabotaged by the British government because it believed in one-to-one diplomacy, not in invoking collective security, and that destroyed any further prospect of it. So the final point I want to make is about the economy. The British economy was far stronger than the German. It survived the depression much, much better than the German economy. Germany is extremely hard hit by the depression, and it took a long time to recover. The recovery was driven by rearmament, but it didn't really happen until the very late 1930s. In the mid-1930s, Britain was in a much stronger economic position to deal with Germany, had it wished to.
Right, thank you. John Charmley has the last word.
How nice, for a change. Well, I did enjoy the Alice in Wonderland world that 2020 hindsight produces, in which this warlike Hitler was always determined on war, was determined on war because he was appeased. Would he have been deterred? Oh, no, some German generals were going to shoot him. Yeah, German generals were always going to shoot Hitler. And when they finally got round to trying to do it, they mucked it up. God, really? Let's commit a whole empire and millions to war on the rumour that some German general's going to get his shot right. That's a good one. Oh, the wisdom of the Monday morning quarterback. It's wonderful. The fact is, the policy was, as Paul Schroeder and Paul Kennedy have said, the most overdetermined in British history. No other was possible. Richard is, of course, quite right. The British economy was strong by 1939. That's because Neville had not bankrupted the country by going for the stupid rearmament Churchill wanted, which would have produced a bunch of medium-range bombers in 1940. Wouldn't have produced, Churchill wasn't in favour of Spitfires or radar. He wanted medium-range bombers. That would have worked. No. Come on. I do hope you've voted the right way. But it was a wonderful exercise in nostalgia listening to the other side. I feel like Eric Morecambe. They gave the same old arguments, but not necessarily in the right order. Thank you.
Right. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you to all of our panelists. Yeah, I know. Well, they don't have the votes yet. As we are still waiting for the vote, I'm going to take away from John Charmley the last word, and I'm going to hand it to this side, because both of them were groaning and making faces at the same time. You were groaning too, but you got yourself. One final response, whichever one of you wants it. Piers Brendan, and then we'll have the vote. After you, no, after
we're,
you.
We're arguing about this. Piers says I'll give it weight. I say he'll give it wit. So.
I think I'm right out of wit at the moment. Half wit, perhaps.
Was this an exercise in nostalgia? You should maybe answer that question.
I think John's position is completely indefensible on this, and I said at the last confrontation that we had with him that I would support any particular argument that he was against, and I certainly. I certainly feel that on this particular occasion we're justified in doing this. I beg of you, do not allow this spurious argument that he has been putting forward to convince you that that he's right.
They voted, Piers.
Oh, have they?
It's too late, and now I have the secret
bill. But also, John's final speech was also far too late because he'd already voted by then. Thank goodness.
Yes, I should point out that some of our panelists voted on the way in, and some of them didn't. So thereby twisting the initial vote. Anyway, we now have the result. Before the debate, there was 25% for the motion, and after the debate, 44% for. Before the debate, there was 41% against the motion. After the debate, 52% against the motion. Ooh. Don't know shrunk from 34% to 4%. So bravo to all the panelists for having changed at least 30% of my...